In the first part of this dive into greenhouse gas emissions, we visualized how carbon dioxide emissions has increased during the last few decades. Now, we will take a closer look at what the sources of these emissions are. The numbers used here are from 2016.
There are, of course, a number of ways to group and display the sources. This is just one way. First of all, 73% of the 49 billion tons of CO2 equivalents emitted were in some way related to energy production. These numbers include all greenhouse gases. So let's divide this large category into smaller chunks. Around a third is related to energy use in industry. 7.2% of the total emissions came from iron and steel manufacturing. And another 0.7% came from the manufacturing of other metals like copper, lead, titanium, zinc, and more. 3.6% came from the category of chemical and petrochemical. This includes emissions from the production of different chemicals like fertilizers, pharmaceuticals, and chemicals used for refrigeration. This category also includes emissions as a result of the extraction itself of oil and gas. 1% came from the industrial part of food and tobacco manufacturing. We will come back to the agricultural emissions of food production. The manufacturing of paper and pulp stood for 0.6%. Production of machinery, 0.5%. Then we have a larger final miscellaneous industrial category of 10.6%. Here we find industries relating to mining, textiles, wood products, cars, and other means of transportation and construction.
And that leads us to the next chunk of 16% of the total emissions, transportation.
The largest part here is road transports, at close to 12%. 60% of these emissions are from passenger travel, and the rest from freight. Burning of petrol and diesel in cars, trucks, buses, and motorcycles are the reason for the high emissions from this sector. Emissions from passenger and freight flights stands for just under 2% of the total emissions. 4/5 of this comes from passenger flights. Boat transportation is way more friendly for the environment per ton and mile than truck or airplane, but it still stands for 1.7% of the total emissions. Finally, we have smaller shares for rail transportation at 0.4%, and the energy needed for pipeline transportation, for example of gas, oil, and water, at 0.3%. 17.5% of the total emissions is a result of energy use in buildings, 10.9% for residential buildings, and 6.6% for commercial buildings. These numbers include lighting, heating, and the use of appliances in apartment buildings, houses, shops, restaurants, offices, and so on. 7.8% of all the emissions come from the category named unallocated fuel combustion. Here we find an assortment of sources, like energy used in pumping water for hydroelectric use at a later time, energy used in nuclear power plants, energy used for different types of plants that make use of the heat generated as a byproduct in electricity production, and energy used in biomass production. 5.8% of all emissions fall under the category of fugitive emissions from energy production. This includes accidental leakage of methane during the whole fossil fuel extraction and transportation cycle. This also includes flaring, on-site burning of excess gas during oil extraction. These types of emissions are a result of both oil and gas extraction as well as coal mining. Finally, we have 1.7% of emissions from energy use in agriculture and fishing, and that sums up the large energy category. Some industrial processes contribute to emissions in other ways than with the energy it demands. Cement production stands for an additional 3% of emissions, due to carbon dioxide being a byproduct of the chemical process in itself. The production of ammonia, plastics, fertilizers, pesticides, and textiles can also be a source of the same type of emissions, and that accounts for another 2.2%. Emissions are also the result of decomposing of wastewater. When organic materials from human, animals, and plants decomposes, methane and nitrous oxide is released, and this accounts for 1.3% of the total emissions. Landfills stands for another 1.9% and is also a source of mainly methane emissions.
And the final large category we will take a look at is agriculture, forestry, and land use.
This includes emissions from changes in land use. 1.4% of emissions are a result of croplands holding less carbon when under stress from human usage. Another 2.2% comes from deforestation. While forests hold carbon, chopping them down for the land to be used for other purposes releases that carbon into the atmosphere. 3.5% of emissions come from slash and burn methods in agriculture. This means the intentional burning of unwanted vegetation to make room for other plants and or to make the ground more nutrient for the sowing of new plants. While this method has been used traditionally in many places, the largest contributions currently are from tropical regions. Rice cultivation also contributes to methane emissions, 1.3% of the total emissions globally. ...4.1% of emissions are the result of fertilizing. The release of nitrous oxide is a consequence of the use of nitrogen fertilizers. And this number includes both usage in agriculture for direct human consumption, growing crops for animal feed, biofuels and non-food crops like tobacco and cotton. Our extensive livestock farms across the planet also contribute to emissions, not the least in the form of methane emissions from cattle. 5.8% of the total global emissions can be attributed to this category.
If we go back to our map of greenhouse gas emissions shown earlier,
we can see that the distribution of different gases is not consistent. The main greenhouse gas, carbon dioxide, is mainly released in electricity production and heating, transportation, manufacturing, construction and maintaining of buildings, other industry, and change in land use and forestry. So countries with high emissions of carbon dioxide have large industries, a big transportation sector, and or are large economies with a large electricity use. Methane, on the other hand, is released in agriculture as a result of fugitive emissions from fossil fuels, from wastewater and landfills. This means that it is less related to economic growth, and so middle and low income nations with large populations accounts for a greater share of the emissions. Nitrous oxide is almost exclusively a result of the usage of fertilizers in agriculture, so we see a similar trend here, where emissions follow population and agricultural output, rather than the size of the economy as a whole. Fluorinated gases are used in a range of industrial applications, mainly in refrigeration.
So why is all of this important? Going into details of how climate change will affect us and our planet is beyond the scope of this video.
But in general, our emissions of greenhouse gases concentrate in the atmosphere and causes the planet to warm up over time. This graph shows concentration of CO2 in the atmosphere from 1850 until now. In 2015, it passed 400 parts per million, and this change is almost exclusively a result of human-induced emissions of carbon dioxide. And this affects the temperature of the Earth. This graph shows the average global temperature from 1850 up until now, as compared to the average of 1961 to 1990. Going back to the CO2 concentration chart, we can change the scale of it to go back 800,000 years. And despite highs and lows in its cycle, it has never gone above 300 parts per million until now.
The effects of climate change are numerous and difficult to project to any degree of certainty.
While some we might have been seeing for quite some time now, others will be noticeable only in the future. Tipping points and inertia in the system also affects our ability to pinpoint consequences to exact levels of emissions. Global warming also impacts the planet unequally, with polar areas in general seeing greater temperature rises than other areas. One of the most eye-catching effects is the increased frequency and severity of natural disasters, like floods, droughts, and storms. This can impact, injure, and even kill people as a direct consequence, but also impact livelihood, destroy crops, and important infrastructure, impacting millions and millions of people further on. A warmer planet also makes the world's ice more susceptible to thawing, and hundreds of millions of people living in coastal areas could see the impact of a rising sea level. Climate change will also have a great impact on other species and could be a driving factor in the decline in biodiversity. Warmer oceans will hurt coral reefs, and warmer air means animals' geographical area will shrink or increase. While everyone will be affected by climate change, the individuals with the least resources will have the hardest time adapting and will be hit the hardest. And while refugee flows will increase as a result of climate change, the poorest will not even have the resources to move.
Going back to the sources of emissions, one picture emerges.
The sources are many and both interconnected and stand alone from each other. And if we would look at national levels, there will be even more discrepancy. There will never be one solution for lowering our emissions on a global scale. Nations at different stages of development, with varying opportunities for energy production and resources, will have to find differing solutions. If we were to rearrange the markers in this visualization, we can see that around a quarter of all our emissions come from food production, alongside a transition away from fossil fuels to renewables or nuclear options, both in electricity production as well as in fuel for our transportation, a shift in land use from deforestation to replanting, and from depletion of wetlands to protection of them. A change in how we, mainly in the richer parts of the world, eat could have a great impact on our emissions. Meat production, especially beef, contributes significantly to our agricultural emissions, so a shift to other meats or a vegetarian diet is probably inevitable if we want to reach our emission targets. One of the major subjects of debate in the climate framework in the last decades has been how to account for middle and low-income nations' opportunities for development, and how we both want to accomplish and not hinder economic development while not emitting as much as the rich nations has historically. So-called leapfrogging, where poorer nations can use modern technology to shorten development cycles, can help significantly. But believing that real development can take place without any increases in emissions whatsoever is probably too good to be true. The focus in the most recent framework from Paris in 2015, and the yearly follow-ups since, more national responsibility, with every nation itself reporting its progress and targets, is not perfect. The differing preferences in goal formulation and the lack of legally binding obligations make it difficult to monitor. But on the other hand, the targets set in the last few years are many times more ambitious than what we saw a decade ago. Today, many nations have zero emission targets set in law by 2040 or 2050. Others are pledging to achieve the same by 2060 or 2070. Today, even China and India see a time past fossil fuel use. And while we are not there yet, it is a major step in the right direction.
Thank you for watching this short series on global greenhouse gas emissions. I have other videos on environmental topics coming up in the future.